Welcome to the presentation on the basics of electric arc furnace steel making part 2. The EAF steel making process was developed for producing special grades of steel using solid forms of it, such as slab, ferroalloys. Solid material was firstly melted through direct arc melting, then refined through the addition of appropriate structures and type for further processing. It is the most important slab recycling process. The most common source material consists of 100% steel slab. Alternative materials used are DRI, HBI, pig iron, and hot metal. Slab formers are lime, dolomite, and recycled refractory material. Carbonaceous additions are anthracite, tooth, and tooth paste. This shows the furnace cross section. These are the three electrodes. This is roof. This is spout for tapping. This is refractory lining. This is metal bar. On top is slag. The slag door, this is the trimming ladder, the tilting mechanism. On this side is the bottom tapping, the slag door, and this is roof, this is refractory lining, this tilting mechanism of the furnace. Important aspects of EAF steel melting are raw materials, melting practice, and mass and energy balance. EAF steel melting uses graphite electrodes which withstands high temperatures and are good electrical conductors. Electric arc between the electrodes and the solid slab provides the heat energy needed to melt the slab. Liquid pool forms the bottom of the furnace. Slab flows on the surface of the molten steel. Important aspects of EAF steel making are raw materials, melting practice, and mass and energy balance. EAF operates as a batch melting process producing batches of heat of liquid steel. EAF operating cycle is called tap-to-tap cycle or a heat and is made up of components, namely charging of the furnace, melting phase, refining phase, desliding operation, tapping of the steel and furnace turnaround. Until only around 30-35 years back, tap-to-tap cycle time were over 3 hours, was quite common, and the specific power uses were often well over 700 kWh per ton. Nearly twice the thermodynamic requirement of 350-370 kWh per ton. These days, tap-to-tap time is normally less than 60 minutes in modern EAFs. Some thin shell furnaces operations are achieving tap-to-tap times of 35 to 45 minutes. A new heat is in this EAF begins with the charging of the slab. It is the initial and an important step in the production of the heat. Slab process is prepared in the slab yard for ensuring proper melting in the tunnel steel, good melting condition, and to fulfill the requirement of the specification of the steel blade. The roof electrodes are raised and are strung to the side of the furnace so that charging train can move and place a full bucket of slab over the furnace. The number of charge buckets of slab needed for a heat is dependent on the slab density. The furnace volume, usually 2 to 3 buckets of slab per heat, is aimed for by the blending of the slab. The slab must be layered in the bucket according to size and the density to promote the rapid formation of the liquid pool of the steel in the hearth while providing protection for side walls and roof from the radiations of the electric heat. Other considerations include minimization of slab tapes in which then break electrodes and ensuring that large heavy pieces of slab do not lie directly in front of burners, force which results into the low back of the frame onto the water tool panels. The charge can include lime and carbon, or these can be injected in the furnace during the heat. In many places, the practice is to add some lime and carbon in the slab bucket and supplement it with the injection of these materials. In the case of DRI or HBI, continuous charging with the help of hopper is usually done. This is shown a slab bucket. In the center, heavy slab is charged. Here, the those slab is charged. These are the slab former like lime and dolomite. This is the fine slab is there, and usually light and fluffy slab is in the bottom. So this is where the slab bucket is being charged. This is furnace roof is removed and slab bucket is open, charging the slab, And this is the photograph of the stir pattern, and this is the furnace where the stir is being charged. Melting phase, after charging the roof, and then the electrodes are lowered to strike an arc on the stir. This commences the melting phase of the heat. The melting phase is the heart of the EF operation. Melting is carried out by supplying energy to the furnace interior. This energy can be electrical or chemical. Electrical energy is supplied through the graphite electrodes and normally has a very large contribution in the melting phase. At the start of melting, not all the available power can be applied, as the electrodes may be still in a high position too close to the roof. When the melting operation has advanced further, changing to the tap maximum power is usually applied. At the start of this melting phase, the earth is erratic and unstable. White fins in time are observed, which are accompanied by rapid movement of the electrodes. As the furnace environment heats up, the earth stabilizes, and once the molten pool is formed, the earth becomes quite stable and the average power input increases. Chemical energy is supplied through many sources, which include oxy fuel furnace and oxygen lances. Oxy fuel furnace burn fuel gases using oxygen, and oxygen in its air heat is transferred to the stack by flame radiation and convection by the hot products of combustion. Heat is transferred within the stack by conduction. Once a molten pool is generated in the furnace, oxygen is usually lanced directly into the molten bath. The oxygen reacts with several elements in the bath, such as aluminium, silicon, manganese, phosphorus, carbon and iron. These reactions are exothermic and supply additional energy, thus helping in the melting of the slag. The metallic oxides that are formed go into the slag. The reaction of oxygen and carbon in the bath produces carbon monoxide, which either burns in the furnace if there is sufficient oxygen, and or is adjusted through the direct evacuation system, DES, where it is burned and conveyed to the pollution control equipment. Once the slag charge is melted, the furnace side walls are exposed to intense radiation from the electric arc. As a result, the voltage is to be reduced. Alternatively, creation of a foamy slag allows the arc to be buried, and this protects the furnace shell. In addition, a large amount of energy is retained in the slag and is transferred to the bath, resulting in the improvement of the energy efficiency. On further melting of the slag charge, flat bath conditions are reached. At this point, bath sample and temperature is taken. The bath analysis allows the operators to determine the amount of oxygen needed to be blown through refining. At this point, the operator also starts making operation for the addition of the ferroalloy tapping. At tapping, the amount are finalized after the resulted refining period. Refining operation is carried out after the flat bath condition are achieved. For the removal of aluminium, silicon, manganese, carbon, phosphorus and sulfur from the steel, the refining reactions are dependent on the availability of oxygen. The elements which are to be removed during refining have a higher affinity for oxygen than the affinity of the carbon for oxygen. Thus, the oxygen preferentially reacts with these elements to form oxides, which flows out and go into the slag. In the modern EF, which is operating with a hot heel of liquid steel and slag retained from the previous heat, oxygen is blown into the bath almost entire period of the heat. As a result, some of the melting and refining operation occurs simultaneously. Phosphorus and sulfur level in the furnace charge than what is needed in the steel are to be removed. Normally, the conditions favorable for removal of phosphorus are opposite to those required for the removal of sulfur. Also, once these elements go into slag phase, then revert back into the steel. Hence, slag removal is important aspect in the EF melting. Control of melting metallic constituents in the bath is important for meeting the specification requirement of the steel. Usually, EF operator aims these constituents at lower level in the bath than those specified in the final product. Oxygen reacts with aluminium, silicon and manganese to form metallic oxide, which are constituents of the slag. These metallic tends to the act without sinning before the sermon, they also the act with a fear, the judging the recovery of the fearness in the path. The reaction of Dharman without sinning in the path to produce fear is important, as it supplies a less expensive form of energy to the path and performs several important defining reactions. In a modern EF, the termination of oxygen Dharma can supply up around 30% to 40% of the net heat input to the furnace. Evolution of CO is very important for slag forming. Coupled with a basic slag, CO bubbles are trapped in the slag, causing it to form and helping to bury the erected arc. These steps greatly improve thermal efficiency and allows the furnace to operate at high voltage even after flat bath is achieved. Reserve gases, especially hydrogen and nitrogen, is a concern for steelmakers. Burning of the earth also helps to prevent nitrogen from being exposed to the earth, which it can dissociate and enter into the steel. If the CO is evolved within the steel bath, it helps to strip nitrogen and hydrogen from the steel. Bottom trapping is beneficial for maintaining low nitrogen level because trapping is fast and a tight trap stream is maintained. A high oxygen potential in the steel is beneficial for low nitrogen levels, and the heat should be tapped open as opposed to the clearing of the heat. Dearborization is also beneficial for the removal of hydrogen. De-sliding operation started out to remove impurities in this form of slag from the furnace during melting and refining phases. Some of the impurities in the bath are oxidized and enter into slag. It is helpful to remove as much phosphorus into slag early in the heat. The EF is tilted backward and slag is poured out of the furnace through the slag door. Removal of slag eliminates the possibility of phosphorus reduction. During slag forming operation, carbon is injected into the slag where it reduces a few to metallics, iron, and in the process produce carbon monoxide, which help form the slag. If the high phosphorus slag has not been removed prior to this step of the operation, phosphorus reversion generally occurs. During slag forming, slag may overflow the sill level in the EF and flow out of the slag. Once the desired steel is composition and temperature have been achieved, the trap hole is open, furnace is tilted, and the steel is poured into a timing ladder. During the trapping process, ferroalloy additions are made based on the bath analysis and the desired steel state. Deoxidizing agents are added to the steel to lower the oxygen content. Prior to the further processing, common deoxidizers are aluminium, ferrosilicon, and siltomanganese. While making carbon steel heats, a minimum slag turnover is aimed. A new slag tower is built up during trapping. Slag forming compounds are added in the ladder for trapping so that the slag tower is formed prior to transfer of the heat to the ladder furnace. This shows a spout trapping, and this shows the bottom trapping, these two photographs. Furnace turnaround is the period between the completion of the trapping and the furnace ready for charging for the next heat. During the period, electrodes and roof are raised and the furnace lining is inspected for defective damage. If necessary, repairs are made to the hard slag line and trap hole and spout. In case of a furnace with bottom trapping, the trap hole is filled with sand. Repairs to the furnace are made using mononegative practice of the Dunning mixtures. Furnace turnaround time is normally normally the largest dead time power off period in the tap to tap cycle. With advances in the furnace practices, this has been reduced from 20 minutes to less than 5 minutes in some recent installed furnaces. This shows the material bands of VF. The charge inputs are strap, HRI, DRI, electrode, which is consumed, CO or MgO is lime and dolomite is mineral, toll and thought are input, nature gas or any fuel gas is the input, air and oxygen is the input. Outputs are slag and steel, off gas and dust. These provides the material balance in a year. Energy balance in a EAF states a total minimum of 300 kWh per ton for melting of the steel slab to provide superheat above the melting point of 1520 degrees Celsius require additional energy, and for typical tap temperature requirements, the total energy required usually lies in the range of 350 to 370 kWh per ton. EAF steel making efficiency ranges between 51% to 64%, and as a result, the total equivalent energy input is usually in the range of 550 to 700 kWh per ton in the modern furnace. This energy can be supplied as electrical energy through oxy fuel burners from a variety of fuel sources and by thermal reactions. The energy distribution is highly dependent on rotor materials and consumable source and a unit to the specific machine shop operation. This shows the energy balance, around 30% is thermal energy, 70% electrical energy. The energy taken by steel is 53%, tooling loss is 17%, waste ash takes 20%, and slag takes 10% of the energy. This shows that the power is reduced during the charging operation, and then during meltdown, the power is increased. And this is the power supplied by the burners, and this is the power during the refining period. And this shows the burners supplying the additional energy. And this is the electrodes and the hot spots around the electrodes. This shows the hazardous area of the electric arc furnace, where the various hazardous areas are shown. Recent technological improvements include the foaming slag practice, blowing oxygen in the melt, hot heel operation, eccentric bottom trapping, post-combustion practice, thermal injection, flue gas monitoring and control, oxy fuel furnace, preheating of slag, elimination of radiation sources into charge slab, charging of hot DRI, charging of hot metal, DCR furnace, spin shell, DCR furnace, donut furnace, ultra-high power transformers, energy efficient furnace electrics, improved process control, neural networks, bottom stirring, stirring gas injection, direct current arc furnace, waste heat recovery for EAF, variable frequency drives, and polymer injection. This shows how in last 40 years, how the electrical consumption has reduced from 630 kWh to 350-40 kWh. Type to type time has reduced from 18 minutes to 40 minutes, and electrode consumption has reduced from 6.5 kg to 1.1 kg. And these are the improvements in the technology which has caused this improvement in the furnace. Tuning blocks in slag zone, CO jet technology, oxygen blowing, radar metallurgy are some of the current practices in the EAF steelmaking process. Thank you for listening to the presentation on basics part 2 of electric arc furnace steelmaking.